Before I start, I would like to acknowledge the contributions of my dear friend and co-worker, Carrie Garcia. She's really a core member of the Historic Building Program, and some of you might know that 2 months ago, she became seriously ill. She's expected to have a full recovery, but she's still currently in a hospital in Albuquerque. She joined the cultural resources team at the laboratory in 1991, and in about the mid-90s, she really started this tireless effort of documenting historic buildings at the laboratory, both buildings from the Manhattan Project and from the Cold War eras. And so, because she's really an unsung hero of our historic building program, I'm dedicating the presentation tonight to her. Very little remains of the Manhattan Project era in downtown Los Alamos, and the rustic buildings from the ranch school, such as Fuller Lodge and the bathtub row houses, don't really tell the full story of the engineering and testing efforts related to the wartime development of the first atomic bombs. So tonight, we're gonna go behind the fence, and many of the laboratories and experimental areas of the Project Y were located away from the town site at the location of the present-day laboratory. But while only a handful of historic properties remain behind the fence, my presentation tonight will provide a virtual tour, hopefully you can see it, complete with photographs and maps that will place each remaining facility within the scientific and technological context of the Manhattan Project at Los Alamos, from the beginnings of the project in 1943 to its conclusion in 1946. So I've got some kind of neat slides. I'm not sure if everyone is familiar with these photographs, but the early technical areas at the laboratory were located near existing properties on the Pirata Plateau. We're really familiar here with the Ranch School, Fuller Lodge, and the Bathtub Row buildings. But in an area at the current laboratory called TA-8, there was a fairly large ranching concern called Anchor Ranch, and those buildings were used during the war, in addition to buildings that were at what was called the Pajarito Club in TA-18. And there's a photograph here of what's called the Gomez site, and this is actually a homestead cabin that was used during the war. Let's see. These are some early, these are bunkhouses associated with Anchor Ranch that were used during the war for radiography experiments. So Anchor Ranch is actually important to the story that I'm gonna tell today because it was one of the early technical areas in the site of the Anchor Proving Ground where the little boy device was, where research and development was conducted. And this is a photograph from 1950. But before I go in there, I just have to do a little bit of bomb 101, and I apologize to all of the physicists in the audience. But I think it's important to understand why there becomes an issue later on in the history of the Manhattan Project when a second weapon design needs to be developed. So the little boy, the gun sight, basically, was researching the gun assembled method. And that involved shooting one subcritical mass into another, and that would cause form a supercritical mass, which would result in a release of nuclear energy. This method was, of course, what it formed the core here of the little boy weapon, shown at Tinian. But this research was done at Technical Area 8. Now, I'm gonna probably confuse folks because a lot of times I talk about TA-8, Technical Area 8. I also talk about Anchor Ranch site. A lot of these Manhattan Project sites had later technical area designations, and some of the old-timers will sort of use the code words. So, for example, when I talk about S site, it's also known as TA-16. So here is the location of the laboratory. And I don't know if I can point this out. This is White Rock down here and the town site up there. Technical Area 8, it's probably just easier for me to describe it. If, as you're driving down to the back gate, if you're heading to the up to the Hamas or out to Bandelier, this facility is on your left, just before you get to Technical Area 16. So we have some very interesting aerial photographs from the late 40s, early 1947, this late 1946, early 1947. And so these are some of the earliest glimpses we have into what the Manhattan Project looked like behind the fence. This is a site of gun sight in operation. It's the only photograph I've ever seen where you can actually see the gun emplacements. Here are the guns, and in order to run some of the velocity tests, they were shooting into these targets. The actual gun sight was set down in this ravine, and there were three heavily fortified bunker buildings that remain today. This is the 1950 aerial. What's really interesting about this photograph is it does show the periscope, which no longer exists, but this was the sort of the light tight experimental, periscope facility that allowed the scientists to conduct the remote operations and also to do high-speed photography to understand what was going on and acquire the data for the gun tests. Sorry, I'm having multiple technological disaster here. So this is what it looks like today. So the periscope would have been over here, not part of the building. This is actually two buildings they do not connect. They are set both into this hill slope. This is building one and building three, which is behind the green blast wall. And this shows you about the depth of the building. People always ask me, well, how many rooms are back there in the hill slope? It's just one building, one room. And this is a third building out at Gunsight. This was used primarily for a shop and for storage activities. The other two buildings were really where the control activities in the laboratory space was. No. I'm sorry if I've confused you. These were actually, even though they reused the Anchor Ranch facilities for the radiography work, these bunker buildings were some of the earliest buildings constructed for the research at the laboratory. So those are actually Manhattan Project, very unique bunkered buildings for those gun tests. So basically, the scientists were working with this concept of a fairly simple, I say this as a non-physicist, a very fairly simple assembly method. And then the intention was to use fissile material coming from both Oak Ridge and Hanford. And so you'd have one weapon design and two different types of materials, the uranium-235 and the plutonium-239. But as they were trying to work out these velocity tests at Gunsight, they were simultaneously studying the small amounts of plutonium coming in from Hanford. And one of the places that they were a remote location that was developed for this was out at Technical Area 18. At the time, it was called Pajarito Site or Pajarito Laboratory. And this was set well away from the town. And Emilio Segre's radiography group, they were out there studying the properties of plutonium. This is actually a later photograph. I think it's circa 1952 of the Pajarito site. So to place it, and again, I don't think you're going to be able to read this map. If you're familiar with Los Alamos and the Pajarito corridor, Pajarito site is in Pajarito Canyon as you're coming up from White Rock, or as you used to be able to come up from White Rock. This is a photograph of the actual cabin that was used to conduct the experiments, plutonium experiments. This is not the pond cabin. And actually, I was looking at some records the other day. There are some notations that it was called a Forest Service cabin, which would actually probably be part of the Soil Conservation District use of this area, which would be many years after Ashley Pond left the Pajarito Canyon. This is an actual photograph inside that cabin of the plutonium setup, the research setup. And this is the Pond cabin today. Now, it was built in 1914 by Ashley Pond for use as his office and as a library building. And I really have never found any specific documents that talk about the use of this facility, this building, actually during Segre's use of the occupation of the canyon. But I would assume that every available building out there was used, and it was likely this was used more as an office space. There's a photograph too in the lower part of this slide that shows the interior of the cabin as it is today. Also reading some of the records on the nomination for this building when it is on the State Register of Historic Places, they attribute the furniture actually to Dwight Young, who resided in this cabin after the Manhattan Project, when Technical 18 was in use during the Cold War years. Then after they realized that the plutonium from Hanford wasn't usable in the gun assembled method, the laboratory went through a reorganization, a dramatic reorganization in 1944. So basically, Segre's group identified that there were impurities in the plutonium that would cause the gun assembled method to basically pre-detonate and fizzle. And so they really had a problem, because Grubbs had spent a heck of a lot of money developing the reactors at Hanford, and they had the plutonium coming to Los Alamos, and they didn't have a weapon designed to use the plutonium with. So they came up with a second method of assembly called the implosion method. And I think one of the things that always inspires me about the Manhattan Project is I think it's an interesting history full of really larger than life people, a lot of very interesting stories, but it wasn't just a handful of 10 people who put this whole thing together. It was really a very creative workforce. And one of the things that I've come across in my readings is that there's always a sort of a philosophy of testing where you would test something until it failed, and then you would test it again until it failed. And so they were always coming up with parallel solutions to a single problem. So for the problem for the weapons design, they actually had a second method in the works, even though they didn't know that they were going to have this problem with the plutonium. But it did take a massive reorganization of the laboratory. They had to bring in additional workers, and they also had to expand the facilities. So with the implosion weapons, high explosives research and development became a top priority at the laboratory. And here's a photo of Fat Man, which was the ultimate, the end result of this research done at TA-16 and at some of the other technical areas. And just as a real quick primer on the implosion method, whereas with the gun bomb, you were basically shooting subcritical mass into another subcritical mass of fissile material. And for the implosion weapon, though, you were basically compressing a subcritical mass of plutonium, making it denser and causing it to go critical. And in order to do this, it was a challenging activity. It wasn't, the materials were not readily available. The military basically didn't have the kind of sophisticated high explosives that you would need. The casting techniques were not developed, and the detonator timing had never been worked out. So you were basically trying to do a symmetrical inward explosion. And so while they were working on developing new types of high explosives and methods for casting, and this was out at TA-16, which is actually just right down the road from TA-8. And again, I apologize that you can't see these maps. So there was this important development in high explosive research, and unfortunately, many of the facilities at TA-16 have been torn down. In the 60s, there was a lot of cleanup throughout the laboratory, and then again in the 1990s, There were 28 buildings that were scheduled to be torn down, and so a lot of the old magazines that were still remaining in the old casting building, those were torn down and demolished in the 90s. But this particular magazine was still in use and sort of slid in under the radar, and this is the last high-explosive magazine from the Manhattan Project era. There's one more remaining high-explosives building out at TA-16 that dates from the Manhattan Project. You'll notice that it says 1946, which is technically after the war. But this building, which is still in use, and during the war it was used for high-explosives grinding, immediately post-war it was built for high-explosives grinding operations. This particular building kind of represents the fact that the high-explosive work at TA-16 never stopped. And in fact, it's still ongoing today. So with the implosion method, I like to sort of think of S-Site as this hub of activity where all of this casting was going on, all these operations were going on around the clock, but mostly in buildings where they were verifying and x-raying the casts and pressing or melting the high explosives. But then they had to take these pieces of high explosive and take them and test them in different remote firing sites. So one of the interesting things also is that they had no idea, well, they had to develop methods to actually understand what was going on inside of an implosion. And so they developed 7 diagnostic methods, and at least a dozen technical areas were rapidly constructed and put together just for this, just for testing and observation of the implosion method. So this is actually an aerial photo of TA-14 or Q site, which is one of the observation technical areas. And some of the remaining buildings that most people don't know about because they're kind of either buried within an existing technical area or they're on dirt roads and they're remote and most lab employees don't get out there. There's just a handful of sites that are associated with this observation and implosion testing. And this is technical area 11, which is home to, it's actually called K-Site. And it was developed for the Betatron diagnostic method. And you'll see, if you can see this photograph, these two buildings here were the Betatron and the Cloud Chamber building. Today they're covered in a sort of a concrete berm, but in wartime there would have been a firing pad between the two buildings. And basically the Betatron emitted radiation, and at the same time an explosion went off, and then the data was recorded in the Cloud Chamber building. The building number 1, and I've got photos of these, was the control building because this had to be done remotely. So here is control building. Building 1 out at TA-11, it's still there, built in 1944. And up until recently, these buildings were in use for other types of operations, of course not this Betatron method. But this particular technical area is now being shut down, or parts of it are. TA-11 is actually almost within S-Site. But as you're leaving S-Site and going to the east, there used to be a drop tower facility there, if you're familiar with the laboratory. It's kind of, it's where some of TA-16 you can actually see from West Hamus Road. This is a part of TA-16 that's more sort of deeper in behind the fence.
Is the drop tower gone?
The drop tower was torn down at the end of last fiscal year, so in October, I believe. And here's the Cloud Chamber building. Another interesting technical area that we found when we were doing archaeological survey is a former technical area 12, or L site. And this is an area that most laboratory folks don't know about. It's within TA-67. It's kind of north of TA-14 as you're going along the road out to our site. And this area was developed in 1945, for use for implosion testing and also for recovery experiments, which I'll talk a little bit about later. But this firing pit is actually pretty fascinating. Nobody really knew what it was, and I believe there were several firing pits, similar firing pits at some of the other technical areas that have been long abandoned. I think there's some records from a site called New Site, NU, where there was a similar firing pit. They did it was the terminal observation group that developed this particular technical area, and it just had a few storage buildings, and I think there was a personnel shelter control building, and then this firing pit. If you go up there, if you're out there, this is actually set up sort of on a little hill. And then I tried to take photographs, but they didn't show up very well. If you peer through here, there's actually, the pit goes underground, and you can see little hand rungs where you'd climb down and I guess set up your assemblies. So the terminal observation method, and I'm not an expert on this at all, but what I've read, what I understand is that it was sort of a way to contain your assembly within this firing pit structure, and then after the test, you'd go in and analyze the remains of the shot, and that would help you understand how the implosion actually functioned. Another area that has remaining Manhattan Project, Manhattan Project building is Technical Area 14, or Q site, and this facility used to have quite a few little firing areas and little bunker areas. And right now, it is still an active, I believe it's still an active firing site, but this is the only facility associated with the Manhattan Project operations. Well, out at Q site, they did small scale cylinder implosion tests, and they used the rotating prism camera method, which also involved sort of an X-ray high-speed photography. And this is kind of interesting because I always figured it was one of those general storage buildings that probably didn't do much, but it turns out the role it played was important because it was the shop and the darkroom. And the darkroom aspect of this method was very important because they were developing their X-rays, and that's where the data from these implosion tests, that was really important to that. I'm sorry, the Q site, let me go back. I'll see if I can orient you. Okay, so 14, and again, I'm gonna be blinded for a second here, I'll go over here. Okay, so I've talked about 8, which is right off of West Hamus Road. You can actually, if you know what you're looking at, you can kind of peer and see parts of TA 8. 16 is the last facility before you get to the back gate. Now, 14 is actually on the way to our site. So in order to get in there, it's really more in the heart of the laboratory. It's a lot harder to see. You can't see it from the road, and it's a longer drive to get out to 14 and then 15. And these are actually current firing areas today. But 67, which is where 12, where that old pit structure is, it's actually right up in here, sort of north of TA-14. So these, the ones that I'm talking about right now, are right sort of in this core area of the laboratory. When I talk about 18, it's much lower down here along Parita Road. And this is a really important facility that I'll come back to because there's actually, there are more facilities from the Manhattan Project at TA-18 that have played, they played a really diverse role. And so I'll come back and visit that site. Does that help? Okay, so that's 14. Now, here I am back at 18 again. The reason why is that not only was TA-18 used for Emilio Segre's research into plutonium, but starting in 1944, this area was developed for a test of the magnetic method. So this is one more of those, how do we see inside an implosion? This is another technical area that was developed specifically for that. And today, the two facilities are TA-8 Building 2, which is up at the top of the screen, and 5, which is over here at TA-18. If you're coming up Parita Road, this is where you start going up the hill. Here's Parita Canyon. And this is where the pond cabin is, and this is where the Slotin building is. So these are actually also very intriguing, experimental type of buildings. Actually, they're almost structures because people didn't really work in them or live in them. That's kind of the definition of the structure. What's different about these than sort of like that high explosive magazine that I showed you was this is definitely fortified. It has a, at the end here, has a protective metal cone. And so the shot, firing shot would have happened over here. And then the controls or, and I'm not sure if actually this was remotely operated. I think it was actually remotely operated from building one. And so there are two of these sort of remotely down in the canyon. And the magnetic method, again, you're firing assemblies, but using the way, let's see, what did the explanation go? Basically the, when metal enters this magnetic field, it changes the field, and so they can actually look at some of the properties of the velocity of the implosion. And it also the same facilities is where they did these large-scale tests of assembly right before they did the Trinity test. They were also doing some large-scale firing shots. And here's, now, building two, I'll go back and show you. Building two is probably the one that's gonna get preserved. And it's really hard when you have to make a decision about which buildings they're both very significant, but building two is in much better shape than building five. And building five was actually filled in, the front of it here. Doesn't have that entrance anymore, and you can't open the door. And so, and it's also got a lot of spalling on the concrete. So if we have two, and they are identical, two identical facilities, and we have to choose if we're gonna preserve them, we preserve one. Okay, so, basically, all of these other buildings that we looked at, and when we were talking about how they had to understand the properties of implosion, there was still a lot of uncertainty. There's a lot of the timing of the detonators, the quality of the high explosives. Would you get a symmetrical inward shockwave? How would all this work? Was the velocity correct? With the gun assembled method, they were pretty sure it would work, but with the implosion method, there were enough doubts that they decided to test it at Trinity, and we all pretty much know this story. But they did develop a specific site called V-Site for not only for assembly of the Trinity device, but for working on some of these final sort of weapon size assemblies, and then some shake testing for some of the actually weaponized versions. So once these spheres of high explosives were assembled into a weapon casing, they also then shook them and did environmental testing so that they were basically working towards a deliverable weapon system at the same time that they were doing these sort of firing tests and getting ready to do the Trinity test. I always think, sometimes when I read the history, it seems like it's, okay, then we did this, and then we did the Trinity test, and then we got everything out to the Pacific, but actually a lot of these things were operating in a sort of parallel. And this is an interesting 1946 aerial, I love this set, that the Historical Society has the original set, and my understanding is that they were salvaged from a dumpster. There may be somebody in the room here who knows the story, but these are just a marvelous set of flyovers from the 1946 period that really give you a view of what the technical areas look like from the air, and they were just sort of a window into the Manhattan Project. This particular photo has the no peak fence running right along here. This is the V site. This is the assembly building, and there were originally six buildings out at V-Site before the fire. I always say that, before the fire. And then after the fire, there were two. So here is to place it within 16. So if this is West Hamus Road over here, and if you remember where the cafeteria was or is, and the main administrative part of 16, V-Site is set back in here. And the large casting building that was torn down, building 27, was in this field here. All right, this is what when we talk about assembly at vSite, that was not what was assembled at vSite. That's the gadget, and it's got the detonators in place. That's on the tower, and they would not have shipped that sphere of hive explosives in a flatbed truck. There's some other photos that have more, you can see more tape on the outside, and that's probably more what the gadget looked like. Well, it was in its final days at vSite before it was shipped down to Trinity. So this is what vSite looks like today. Actually, this is what vSite looks like in 2006. This is the High Bay Assembly Building, and this is a small little building next to it that currently was used as a mechanical room, but originally was a small laboratory space. There was one building out at vSite before it was developed for use for those assemblies. And so this was the original, the small little triangular building was the original laboratory up there. So moving along, they've decided to go ahead with the test, and they're readying the gadget for the Trinity device. But there is this concern about plutonium recovery. And that means what the concern stemmed from was that basically with this, the doubt that they had, there was a possibility that you'd have more of a conventional explosion at Trinity, and you really wouldn't have a nuclear explosion. And so they had very little plutonium left over, or plutonium at the time, and they didn't want to lose it. So in true laboratory fashion, they came up with four or five methods look at a way to recover the plutonium. Most people are very familiar with and this is the location of a lot of the recovery work, which is at Two Mile Mesa site, or TA6. And that blue dot is our 200-foot diameter concrete bowl that still remains from the recovery experiments. Most people are familiar with the story of Jumbo, and that was the recovery method that they eventually chose to use, and then actually didn't use it. This is Jumbo at the Trinity site. But a lot of people aren't as familiar with the water recovery method. It's also called the water baffle method. And this is, we just describe it as the concrete bowl because that's what it looks like. It's a scale model, 200 feet in diameter. And this was found within the last couple of years. This is a photo of the bowl actually in use. There's a man up here, and that's a water barrel. And the idea is that an assembly would be detonated in that barrel, and the water and the plutonium stand-in, which was depleted uranium, would come down, and then it would drain. And there's a filter system in the bottom of this bowl. I have a modern view of that. That's what it looked like. I think that's pre-fire. That's 1991. Some people used to call it Eye from the Sky or something like that. It has a couple of odd names. And the elk actually use it as a watering hole. So after they ran through, and so we had this, also the firing pit was another recovery method. And then there was some sand shots conducted out at TA6. There were also jumbinos, so miniature jumbos were also tested out there. So that's what I like, the creativity and almost the endless resources to try several directions of experimentation. So we're ready to go to Tinian. And the last one of the last stops for the Fat Man was Trapdoor Site. This is a photograph, also, I think it's from the 50s, there is a 46 one I couldn't find. And on that one you see, this is the Fat Man assembly area. They actually had a large no-peak fence actually running along in front of that Quonset Hut complex. So only a few areas of the laboratory had those no-peak fences, and those were the ones that were the most significant, the most secret, associated with the final assembly work. So I guess if you could get out behind the fence, you still weren't allowed, unless you had a need to know, to get into some of these facilities. So this is Technical Area 22, where the Quonset Hut complex is. This is actually the Quonset Hut's location today. This is where the Fat Man assembly work was done. And to place it, I'm gonna zip over here again. Okay, so TA6 is actually just a little bit higher up, 6 and 22. They're more in this area of the laboratory. and that's the Quonset hut. I saw a photograph of it the other day, and I don't know what it dates to, but it actually has sort of a high explosive protection berm in front of it, sort of one of the more modern 1950s metal ones, not a wooden berm. So I'm not sure what that was associated with. This is today, it does not have any of that protection. And where that car is, there's actually an addition that was a changing room for when this facility was converted from the after the war to a detonator facility. And this is a couple more views of it. It's not in great shape, but when we had to do the restoration priorities, V-Site was about ready to fall down, so we got the first restoration money. It's going to be the next candidate after we do the gunsite restoration. So one of our remaining facilities was actually after the war, still within the technical limits of the Manhattan Project, because it really didn't end until the Atomic Energy Act and the Atomic Energy Commission was established. And so this is, again, we're back at TA-18, post-war, where they were doing criticality research. And I'll skip through, well, except for the fact that this is, now I'm talking about what we call the Slotin Building in honor of Lewis Slotin, but its real designation is TA-18 Building 1, and it's within the sort of administrative complex. Okay, so in the building itself was built in 1944, and I believe it was actually used as a control building for some of those battleship bunker experiments. But it's very well known for the fact that it is the location of the May 21st, 1946 criticality accident that involved Lewis Slotin and several other folks. It's in actually fairly good condition because it was up until recently used as a shop building. This is a fairly recent building picture of it, but most of this has now been cleared out because the TA-18 Pajarito site is now in what's called site closure. And most of the operations are going to be moved to Nevada. And so the entire facility is going to be shut down, and we're looking at a plan to figure out which of the buildings at 18 are going to be preserved. And we know right away that the Slotin Building is definitely a candidate for preservation, and the Pond Cabin is also a candidate because it's on the state register and it has the World War II significance. Okay, so we have, I've probably talked about, I think about 18 facilities. But of those, the top six are the Quonset Hut, the Concrete Bowl, the Slotin Building, Gunsite, V-Site, and the Pond Cabin. And so those are our top priorities for restoration and preservation. Like I said, the Quonset Hut's not in great shape, but the Gunsite's actually, even though the concrete is stable, all the exterior work here is really dilapidated and is starting to actually fall. And so we are starting a cleanup of that area this year. But before I talk about that, I'll just briefly talk about the restoration project. The V-Site restoration project was the very, very first major restoration project of a Manhattan Project building, I think anywhere, and it was definitely our very first restoration project here at Los Alamos. We've been spending a lot of time documenting buildings before they got torn down, and so we basically had to start from scratch to figure out how to save a building and then restore it. First was to get money, and so we submitted an application for a Save America's Treasures grant, which we did receive in January of 2000. It was a matching grant, so in order to release the federal funds, we had to actually get some in-kind private funds. And once we were still working on that when the May 2000 Cerro Grande fire hit. And the fire went through V-Site very quickly and burned the radiography building, which is shown on the slide, and also a covered sort of carport area and a couple of the other laboratory buildings. So almost miraculously, the assembly building, which is the most historically significant building out there, was saved. So several years later, when we finally get all the funding, we decided to work on the V-Site restoration, but to break it into three doable phases. Actually, we ended up doing phase one and phase two first, and then had some leftover money and a congressional earmark for the preservation of Manhattan Project buildings. This was an old earmark. We're not getting any new ones. But this was one that we shared that money with Hanford and Oak Ridge. But the first two phases involved some of the structural issues. The berm, which is this earthen berm, which protected not the building's occupants from high explosive, but the next building over those occupants, in case there would be an explosion in the building. And so that berm, which was a safety measure during the war, became a real problem because water got into it, and the earth started basically decaying the back retaining wall, and then it moved its way into the back wall of the assembly building. So at the time, I grew up in Oregon, and I must have gotten sensitized to mold and mildew. And when I came here, I never had any problems. As a kid in New Mexico, it's very dry. I would step foot in this building and I'd just start wheezing. And this is because at the time, before it was cleaned up, all of this dirt would kind of come into the building, and it was actually growing this layer of green. If you can see that, that's actually green kind of moldy stuff. So it's one of the hazards of doing historical building work. There was also some asbestos issues that we had to take care of. And then the entire building, these are wooden buildings with asbestos shingles. We were allowed to only, we didn't have to remove the original asbestos shingles. We could leave them in place and just repair some of the spots that were missing shingles. So we're very lucky with that. The cosmetic repairs, you'll see in the next photograph, we refinished the doors, windows, and then the shingle repair. Okay, so this actually, you won't see that in the next photo. This is what it looked like before. It was in really, very, really bad shape. And like I said, the back wall was about ready to fall in, and the whole building would have gone. The roofs were actually, you could see daylight in the smaller triangular building 517. And 516, there was a lot of concern about the stability of the roof. This is what happened in the very first phase. We had to remove the earthen berm. And the berm wall itself here is really, really decayed. And so none of that was salvageable. This is the back berm wall of building 517. And that was in better shape, but they still had to do some repair work. This gutter failed and also caused sort of a hole in the berm and then allowed water to go into the back of that building. It was a mess. So then we replaced the berm with actually original soil because we couldn't move it off site because of lab environmental rules. But we reseeded it. They built an entire new berm retaining wall here. They re-roofed this building and they made it better. We actually talked to the state and said, you know, these buildings were designed to be around for a few years. We were going to spend a lot of money restoring them. We'd like them to be around a little bit longer than 5 or 10 years. So we actually redid the drainage on this roof, and that leads down to the smaller roof and then into a French drain system. So it's a better drainage, and it keeps the water off the roof. This is what it looks, the other slide is that it was, this is what it looks like in 2006. This is what it looks like today. In 2007, and I can't remember why, but John Isaacson, who was the originator of this project and who loves this building, decided it would be really cool if we could replicate the No Peak fence. And originally, the No Peak fence would have gone all the way down here, but we didn't really have enough money to do that. So we replicated a section of it, and these are based on the original plans. One of the cool things about the laboratory's historic building program is that we actually have every drawing, all the original drawings for all of Manhattan Project buildings, even if they've been torn down. And so it was, we had the original plans, so we rebuilt the gate, and we actually, a gentleman salvaged some of the original berm wall timbers and used those to make the gate. So when you come walking down and you see V-Site, you actually see this this gate and the No Peak fence, and you can't actually see what's behind, so it kind of gives you the feeling of what it would have been like in World War II, where you had this separate exclusion area for those with a special badge and a special need to know. So our next priority is the restoration of gun sight. And this is that 1950s slide. I put that one in there to remind you of this really interesting periscope structure. Originally that would have been here. Our primary focus right now is on removing these structures, which were actually not, they call them non-contributing, because we want to restore Gunsight to the 1944 look, and these were added in 1947 to 49. So since those are the ones that are falling down, it's actually really convenient that we don't have to replace them. So we're going to do a tear down mode. And you can see this is kind of a close-up of how these are actually almost condemned. We can't even walk up on these stairs anymore because it's just this roof here is really settling. Everything is falling down. This is lead-based paint and asbestos. So I actually got a secondary grant this year from a laboratory cleanup fund. So we're going to come in and remove it, and they're going to take the waste away, which is really nice. Our plans for the second phase, our immediate plans was we wanted to get the restoration plan approved by the state, which we did, and we want to start the cleanup phase this year. But then this facility has a lot of spalling along this edge, and that needs to be repaired, and we're not sure what the roof looks like, and it's covered by earth. So we're going to have to pull the earth back, remove a lot of the vegetation, and look at the condition of the roof. The third phase, which I don't know if it'll happen before I retire, but a lot of people want it to happen, is to rebuild the periscope structure. And TA-8, and I don't have a map of it, but you can see TA-8 from the road, which means this is one facility that's actually closer to being outside of the fence. And so there are people in, we have sort of interest groups. We have the Atomic Heritage Foundation, Energy Communities Alliance, other national level groups that are looking at what I do with these buildings. And they are actually hoping that one of these days we can change the alignment of the fence in this area so that the public can come into the gun site. Now at this point we were supposed to show a film, but since we started late, I don't think we're gonna show it. So if you have, this is a good time then for questions, and I will try my best to answer them. And then I believe we're gonna have, do we have refreshments afterwards? Okay. There was a ranching concern called Anchor Ranch that was where they had bought several areas of land that had been homesteaded originally, combined it together, had a main ranch building, bunkhouses, different cabins.
Was Anchor an Anglicization of the Spanish word?
I don't believe so. Dorothy might know. Dorothy's in the audience. But I believe they just called it Anchor Ranch. Yes, Dorothy? An anchor is an anchor. What's interesting too, because people ask me about it, but I don't think there's any correlation, is if you look at the alignment of the road at Anchor Ranch, it looks like an anchor. So the modern TA-8, there's a big drive out, and then there's a sort of a loop road where they put the different anchor, the modern TA-8, 1950s. Okay. At 46?
Yeah,
TA-46. I'm trying to think.
Roller program.
Right, but I think it was post-Manhattan Project.
Okay, so. The other point is TA-8 is also known as GT site.
Right, Gerald Tenney, yeah.
And he ran the non-destructive test group, which is where allegedly, and there's some good reason to believe it might be true, in September 47, samples were brought up from Roswell. If you have any questions, come ask us. We'll tell you about it.
TA-8 has a long and noble history that extends well past the gun sight use. In fact, the 47 and 49 changes to that facility were because they were no longer doing gun testing there. They had moved that to TA-33. And so there's a lot of other work that the Cold War work. In fact, I don't manage just Manhattan Project buildings. There are several hundred very significant Cold War buildings that date basically from 47 all the way to, I think I manage a building that was built in 1985. So because the laboratory is a nationally significant place, we have a lot of very historically significant buildings. So let me see. I'll ask Ken. Yeah.
I remember GMX2 office building where Lou Smith was in, and there was some kind of concrete job or something next door. I never got into that. But GMX2 had a whole new facility built across the road, which I was in and out of. It's TA-8, part of that old concrete something, which I don't know what they used it for, but it looked kind of ancient. Up the road from GMX1 or GT's side.
I think so. I mean, it's right next to the building 8, I want to say 20, I was getting wrong. The main administrative building that's right there at GT site or TA-8.
Yeah.
It's just like a block up the road.
Right.
And it's set down. They describe it as being in a ravine, but it's really kind of a drainage. I mean, it's not that dramatic, but it's very close. You can see it from the modern TA-8 facilities. Yeah. Yes.
The ice house is gone, but was there any documentation? So you obviously can't restore it, but do you have any documentation about what it looked like inside before it actually pond?
No, there are several ice houses. So you're talking about
the ice house.
Yeah, that because that, and I correct me if I'm wrong, I believe that the original ice house was a ranch school building.
It was log.
So we don't have those drawings.
There was a stone one then that they presumably the Manhattan Project used.
Right, but we don't have, if they didn't build it, we don't have the drawings for it. But we have everything that the military built. Drawings. Yes, in the back.
Because so much is gone, and because we do have drawings, are virtual reconstructions of Manhattan Project sites part of the national preservation process?
They encourage us to be very creative. We just documented a Cold War, a large press, high explosive press in building 16430, if you're familiar with TA-16. And the requirements are to do an engineering study that also included, we did sort of, I call it the David McCauley How Things Work kind of drawing. And we animated that as well. And so there was also another video production done by, oh goodness, was it the History Channel? I think it was History Channel, I'm looking at Danny. Where they tried to do a recreation of how the gun assembly, how those shots would be done at the gun site, and how the periscope was used in conjunction with that. So that is something that is not out of the realm of possibilities with the new technology. So we are trying to get, in fact, one of the things that we're trying to do is put sort of a small brochure pamphlet together of where the photographs and history of the remaining buildings, and with some locational maps that you could actually see. And so, and that would be something we could distribute to the public.
Yeah, well, let me comment on that. That's a good question, because that's kind of on the table for the National Park in Los Alamos, is to do, since we obviously can't build the buildings, is to try to do a virtual tour. And so we've actually talked to the company here that does that. Just rubbing noses.
The LIDAR kind of documentation?
I'm sorry?
The LIDAR documentation, the...
No, actually, to do a virtual tour of TA-1.
I think there's a lot of options out there because we do have drawings. We actually do have the drawings for, and I didn't have time to describe it, but out of the gun site, the guns were actually covered when they weren't in use with these wooden buildings that were on rails that could be pulled back, and then they covered the guns so they could be protected from the elements, and then also people could see them. We found those drawings, and so every once in a while someone tries to offer me a naval gun. And in addition to restoring the periscope, the idea would be we could set up sort of a replica, a recreation of that actual, the gun setup, the emplacements up on that flat area above the gun site, and then basically rebuild one of those the wooden buildings on rails. So there's lots of opportunities. Of course, that sounds like a lot of money to me. Yes, sir.
When are they going to finish moving Pirate Society so that we can visit Pond Cabin?
That's an excellent question. We are in the middle of closure, which means that they're still removing items. Primarily, it's housekeeping right now from those buildings. They don't have funding, I believe, to do the teardown work that they wanted to do on the rest of the buildings. But they should get to a point, it's called cold and dark, where most of anything technical in there would have been removed, and the remaining buildings that are there would be relatively safe. Because they're still cleaning out that facility, it's really not appropriate for visitors to come in. But I have noted that if you look at the layout, security layout of the laboratory, the 18 is actually fairly close to being, it's not really even behind the fence. It's not within a security area anymore. All of that has been relaxed. But it is behind the Pajarito corridor. And so my goal is to preserve at least the Palm Cabin and the Slotin Building out at TA 18. And then also on the table are some Cold War buildings. We're talking about retaining Casa 1. Some of the remote control criticality work, they used to be called Kivas. We're also talking about retaining the one of those battleship bunkers, and then there's a hillside vault that is a small, very much smaller version of the TA-41 vault, but that's out there. And so those are the buildings that we're looking actively at retaining, and then those would be interpreted, and hopefully, once the site is ready for visitors, I don't think it may not take much to bring that security perimeter back for like a weekend or something like that, and so that people could see the cabin. Now, I know that some of the family members, the Pond family, have requested to come visit the cabin. One of the issues we have is that we do need to do a stability study. We had the Park Service come out 2 years ago and look at the cabin, but it is, I think, going to need a little bit of structural work in the near term.
When is it going to be finished?
I document the buildings. I'm not in charge of the closure. They were expecting, my understanding is they were actually expecting some money, government money to direct them to do that. And it's been on the list. There is a management goal at the laboratory to close out a lot of facilities that are not being used. So it's actually on the top of the list. It may be a couple of years. Okay. That's a good question, too, because a lot of these buildings have been abandoned. The V-site was, I think, last used in the 60s. And so in the interim, most of these buildings have been just cleaned out. So there wasn't much of the historical equipment left in them. And so when we restored V-site, we basically did a very light touch on the interior. There really wasn't any equipment left over. We brought in a kettle that had been used at the casting building. And there's actually some interpretive information out at V-site. One of the best buildings that had vintage equipment in it was the casting building, and we had salvaged all that so we could use it for interpretation. Unfortunately, it all burned in the fire. That was one of the real sad low points of my career. But it is very difficult to find the vintage equipment dating from the Manhattan Project. A lot of it's just been cleaned out.
Yes, because it's a black hole.
The vault is one of our premier Cold War facilities. It's actually in active use. And we have, and that actually falls on with your question, that particular Cold War building has a bank vault system in it and shelving. And we have worked with people who are using the facility so that they will not remove or damage any of the original fixtures, in hopes that one of these days when it's no longer being used, when we interpret that facility, you'll still have that really impressive Cold War original fixtures.
So thank you for your patience this evening. I hope it was worth the wait. Since this is an ongoing story, I believe we'll see Ellen and her colleagues back in this room in this lecture series from time to time to show us what has happened. And hopefully some of this will finish before you're finished. So with that, let's show our appreciation for Ellen. There are refreshments in the back. Thank you very much.